As everybody knows, a climate disaster that Pakistan's Federal Minister of Climate Change has called apocalyptic is ravaging across Pakistan. One third of the country is currently underwater. 1,300 people are dead. 50 million people are displaced. Amna, Sabine, and I are planning a trip, a disaster relief mission at the end of this month. And because we've been getting a lot of questions from everybody, we've decided to hold this little Zoom call where we would be able to, via video, and so that we don't have to take up everybody else's time as well. You guys can see it whenever you guys have time. We're going to be discussing what we have seen. As a lot of people already know, Sabine and I were on the ground in 2010. I was providing medical relief while Sabine was doing disaster relief, and then continued to work in rehab and recovery with the same people that she started the disaster relief work with. Sabine has extensive experience working in the NGO sector. She's got about 10, 15 years of experience, so she's going to get into what she's been hearing from, what she's hearing about. The destruction, the level, the magnitude of despair, and what her field officers have been telling her, people that she's worked with in the past. And then we're going to get into, Amna and I will get into discussing why it is that we're going, and what it is that we plan to do when we're on the ground. Sabine?
What is the actual situation on the ground? Since you're the one who's most in touch with people on the ground and you've been following the news, and the way you can follow it because you have extensive experience with relief work. So please tell me, what's the situation on the ground?
Okay, the destruction is of such magnitude. If you put 2005 earthquake and 2000, if you combine 2005 earthquake and 2010
In
flood
Pakistan, in
together,
Pakistan, in Pakistan, yes.
this flood is much worse in terms of destruction, in terms of magnitude. Like those two
Were
weather.
very bad, and now you're saying this is much, much worse.
Yeah, those two put together,
Yeah, unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
there is no comparison. Like we were there when the earthquake hit, we were there when the flood hit
In 2010.
in 2010. Yes, the amount of livestock, houses, agriculture land, it's unbelievable. Like you're there, you're seeing it with your eyes, but your mind doesn't accept the
Wow.
disaster, the lives lost. It's unbelievable.
Yeah. For those who don't know about earthquake in Pakistan or 2010 floods, that was also very, very on magnitude.
Devastating, yeah.
It was devastating. And what Sabine is telling us is that now those two combined, this is much worse than that. So I can't.
Sabine, do you remember the numbers of how many people were affected by the floods? I'm sorry, by the earthquake? Do you remember?
No, I don't remember.
Because I remember in 2010 that the final number was 33 million. I remember that. That
Yeah.
they said it was 33 million people were affected in the 2010 floods, and being on the ground for both Sabine and I, the damage was catastrophic. I mean,
Yeah.
I'm talking about 10 feet of water, 4 months out, still large swaths, like huge expanses of land, still 10 feet underwater.
And for earthquake, one of my friends, she was going for disaster relief there, and she told me that like there was one mountain she was doing having construction done for another project there, and she said the mount that same mountain that she had seen so many times, the mountain split. And you're telling me, Sabine, that this is those two combined, this is much worse than that. That's unbelievable.
That's unbelievable.
Yeah, of course, these people remember, like, First, they were hit by torrential rains.
Yeah.
Just like 24 hours ago, they're hit by flash floods. So already like close to 40 million people are displaced. Like they didn't have the time even to salvage whatever they could. Because it's like one thing after another.
And post-COVID too, and inflation. And these people are in poverty-stricken areas anyway. And these are small farmers. These are small cattle herders. These are
fishermen. Their standing crop is all gone. Cotton, rice, sugarcane. This is right now. And like after these crops, say starting January, they plant wheat. The agriculture land is like useless completely for at least a year.
That's what I remember too.
And they depend on their agriculture. Well, it's their asset. They use it all year round.
Yes.
They store their wheat. They use that all year round.
All gone.
They sell it in pieces.
Yeah.
And also, Sabyn, correct me if I'm wrong, but a lot of these farmers also, when even in normal situations, when floods are not there and when there is no, aren't they working in debt anyway?
Yeah.
Yes.
Year round, like they're forever in debt.
Which we call the intergenerational cycle of poverty.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well.
Yeah. Like the land they're working on is not theirs. Fertilizer, seeds, whatever they use, it's given by somebody on a very high
interest rate.
On a very high interest rate. And they never get out of it.
Yeah, they're in sort of like, it's bonded labor in a way.
So these are, generally speaking, what we're talking about is bonded laborers that are now affected, and they're the most affected. They're the most devastated.
Even though bonded labor has been abolished in Pakistan, but it still exists. Everyone knows that.
So, Amna, what is the motivation behind? We've been getting a lot of questions. A lot of people, objections, questions. I mean, you know, neither here nor there. That's not the relevant part.
Yeah.
Why are you choosing to go to Pakistan yourself?
Right. And I want to say that, yes, there's a lot of objections, and I've been waiting to start my job, and it's finally starting. But I still am going to go. And I'm so thankful to my employer that they are understanding of this.
Yeah.
You and Sabyn told me that this is happening and we're going to go, and I didn't even think about how am I going to do this. I said, I'm going. Yeah. And my motivation to do this is multifold. I've always done human rights work, and I'm always trying to help people. And part of that is because I do believe, even though my life has been difficult, but I do believe that I was born in privilege and given opportunities that millions of others
don't get.
And my father used to say that those of us who are born with privilege, it is our duty to then serve others who don't have the kind of choices we have. And I also believe that right now, especially right now, like Sabyn is saying, 2010 floods and earthquake combined, this devastation is much worse. And I feel like I'm from Pakistan. I went to med school in Pakistan. I did my medical education debt-free. My colleagues have $500,000 debt when they finished medical school. My country of origin provided me this medication, this education free, almost free. So it is my duty to serve wherever I can, however I can. And this is why I'm going.
To say first things first, I mean, you have an extensive record in and an exemplary record in human rights advocacy and all the work that you've done in Pakistan, which is phenomenal. Aside from that, you're a pretty distinguished doctor. So we're all very lucky that you're going to be joining us and we're going to go out there and do all this work. The question for me is, a lot of people pose the question, why aren't you doing this in India? For those of you who don't know, I am Indian. Born in India, raised in America. So a lot of people turn around and pose the question to me as to why I'm not going, why I don't do this in India. I have certain reasons for that. It's not as easy for me to go get up and go to India. Not logistically, obviously, that's very easy. But as a physician going into parts of India, you have to meet a lot of restrictions. You have to register your organization. You have to do this. We have not done that. We don't have the financial backing for that. While in Pakistan, it's been quite a bit easier to get set up on the ground. One, I did that in Pakistan. We are a registered social welfare trust in Pakistan. We are a registered nonprofit in the United States. All of this was done in 2010, which is when LifeBridge was founded. So we have on the ground base properly. Plus, because of the work, the extensive level of work that Sabine and I were engaged in for the 2010 floods, we have a very close and supportive network there. So it is not like we're just picking up and just showing up there with nowhere to go and no idea of where to get started. We have all of the groundwork laid. The food distributions have already started. They will, of course, get amped up when we get on the ground because we're there to manage it ourselves. And we are the ones who are bringing the funds there. And of course, to make sure that mismanagement doesn't happen. But because we
How
always
much
say
of the funds get to the affectees.
100%. I have always done everything since 2010. Everything has been volunteer from my side, from LifeBridge's side. 100%. We have never, I've never taken a salary. I've never taken a stipend. I've never had any of my expenses except the basic stuff like visas being paid through any of LifeBridge's efforts, nothing. So whatever fundraising has always been done has always gone 100% to the affectees. That's it. No questions asked. I mean, even now when all three of us are going, we're sponsoring our own tickets. None of us are taking any of the funds being raised to and putting it towards our own personal travel. So that's another important thing that I've been asked a lot in the last 10 days since we've started fundraising.
I want to ask Sabine.
And also one thing, that even the people that we work with, they're all volunteers. Nobody is a salaried staff. So that's how, and we have like zero overheads.
Yeah, and we're as we are arranging our trip, we're each of us are connecting with our contacts in Sindh and Southern Punjab, and then they are also volunteering to help us and do, you know, whatever they can. So we're creating a network, which we have already created, and we're just tapping into our network.
Yeah, like we all have our own separate networks, right? I mean, Amna, you have yours through your human rights experience and all the years that you spent in Pakistan.
Yes.
I have people that I worked with through LifeBridge from 2010 till 2013. And then Sabine, of course, has her extensive 15-year track record, stellar as hell, that, yeah, you know, over the course
working
of...
Working for UN OCHA and then working, creating LifeBridge and working with LifeBridge and... Sabine, do you want to tell us a little bit more about what you've heard from people whose villages have been swept away?
Okay, so I have been following the floods since 3rd or 4th week, July. Of course, since 2 months, the rain did not stop. It was continuously raining. So the first news that started circulating, it was out of Balochistan, that villages are getting inundated, like district after district, city after city. And then...
And that's just from rain.
Yeah, just rain. Torrential floods hit. Yeah. Then, of course, it started everywhere. KPK, that other side of Gilgit, Punjab, especially southern Punjab. The devastation in southern Punjab is
horrible.
Like, it's something that we have never seen.
Yeah.
3 days ago. Now it's only...
I'm worried about those people that I was looking at that are stranded in the middle of...
Yes.
Like where they're saying that the ocean is in the center, it's like outside of main city Sakhar, where the Kachi Abadi starts, is where, and when they say Kachi Abadi, I'm sorry, I need to explain that. So that means that these are parts of the region that don't have infrastructure. They don't have roads. They're basically mud pathways that go lead into the village and back. So it's all mud and agricultural land.
Also, both sides of River Indus.
Right, both sides of the River Indus that run along the banks. So all of those areas now are kind of, there were huge expanses of agricultural land, and now there are oceans in the center of it separating certain villages from the main city roads. And there's, in the video, the way that they were showing it is that Hamid Mir was, I'm sorry, I'm talking about the video that was Hamid Mir. So he's getting in from main city Sakhar into a boat in a region that I've been, by the way. I've been to that area. And he's getting into the boat and he's taking the boat across. And when he, it's almost like 5 or 7 minute boat ride. And then at the end of the boat ride, there's a small expanse of land, which is in the middle. Basically, it's a mound. It looks like a little mound that probably was a little higher up. It looks like a little island. All the trees that are like normally 10 feet and 11 feet high are half underwater. And these people are sitting on these cots that are kind of like just sitting in the middle of the water, trying to protect themselves from, I guess, and he's saying that it's already the mosquitoes, the bugs, the snakes have already started. We're all starting to get sick. We don't have access to food. And now I was worrying,
not access to safe water.
No, obviously not. The only water that they have is the water that they're surrounded by, which is full of garbage that's now coming out. And then the mosquitoes and the bugs are starting to get on top of that, populate. And then the people are getting sick. And I mean, defecation, going to the bathroom, all these things are such, like when you start to think, you spiral. It's like, if they're surrounded by water, where are they going to the bathroom? So that water is kind of lapping up onto that area where they have land, and then it's going right back into, so the poop and the pee and everything else is going into that water. I'm not just talking about human, I'm talking about even the livestock that they have.
Livestock, yeah.
It is also clearly going to the bathroom, so it's just mixing with the water that's right there underneath them. They're sitting on top of that. They're just, it's like a
cesspool of infection.
Yes, a cesspool
that
of
they're
infection.
Sitting on.
And that was what my observations were when I was in 2010, when I was there. There was a prevalence of eye infections, skin infections, diarrhea, bloody and watery diarrhea. What did you say?
Acute diarrhea.
Yeah. Acute and chronic. we started to see infectious disease explode. Measles, because remember, all of these people are living in tent cities. First of all, right now, there's no tent cities. So they're just basically in the open air in close proximity to each other, trying to like huddle around and get save themselves from the water. So they're on small like patches of land, and they're bringing all their wet, you know, blankets and whatever. Everything that they own is pretty wet right now. So it's all attracting infections, bacteria, bugs. And then on top of that, when they do get the tent cities are built in such a way that they're hardly like a foot apart from each other. Because they have small parts of land that they set these tent cities up. So it's such close proximity that all infectious diseases now suddenly become a thing. Like malaria, if that one kid gets malaria from the mosquito, guess what? all those kids are getting malaria because that mosquito is attacking the entire tent city. It's not exclusive. They're not far apart. So they're very close. That's one. Two, pneumonia. One person gets it, everybody gets it. It's like wildfire. So, and there are tons of pregnant women who are
malnourished to begin with. And now
malnourished to begin with, yes. So malnutrition is a thing, is a reality, which gives them bad immune systems anyway. They're not, their immune system is not at its peak because they're malnourished. So, and then now they're
and the stress, you know, we all know that stress is also a risk factor for your, for you to get low immunity. So
yeah, so I was going off on a list of things, and it's eye infections, skin infections, cholera, bloody diarrhea, communicable diseases like measles, worms, pneumonia, tuberculosis, malaria, fungal diseases, vitamin deficiencies from poor diet anyway, but now it starts to even get more magnified, like they end up with night blindness, and then trauma.
Upper respiratory
yeah. infections, yes, pneumonia. I said pneumonia. So, and then of course the flu, COVID is a thing still in Pakistan. So COVID is going to be all around.
Dengue,
yes, and
did
trauma.
You know that, measles.
I did say measles.
Yeah.
Trauma, that is from accidents because they can't see where they're putting their feet. They are barefoot, so they have more skin infections because they can't walk with slippers in 4 foot water, in mud. It's not possible. So they end up with like some people lose limbs because of the kind of accidents that they have. I had a patient that showed up with it was a small cut that she got in her foot because she was walking in the water and she slipped it on something that she couldn't see inside the water. And by the time she got to me, which was probably 2 weeks later, her entire foot was gone. It had to be debrided. I mean, she didn't lose it, thank God, because I was able to see her and then debride her foot. But and nurse it back, but it was a bad scene. So you have to, like, it's surgical too. It's not just, you know, giving people medicines. There's a lot of damage. And then one thing that nobody talks about, but we all know the effects of, because in Pakistan, when you're in this kind of a situation, these people don't even have an understanding of depression and anxiety. So we're treating depression and anxiety, but they don't know that that's what's going on, because really, what's the point of telling them that? Because they can't seek out care anyway. So depression and anxiety is a very big thing. It's a very real problem when you're on the ground.
You lost everything.
Of course.
There's no hope. To begin with.
You were in debt to begin with. There's no hope. Your kids, you don't know where your next meal is coming from. You can't even begin to fathom or understand that how you're not going to have an income for a year because it's the only thing you know how to do. It's not like you know how to do a bunch of other things. You're a farmer by trade, by life, by education. I mean, real life education. But it is a... in my personal opinion, it is definitely a disaster of epic proportions. And as people, to answer the question and not to go back to it, why do I do what I do is purely because I'm supposed to, because I can. I can't move mountains politically. It's not my thing. I don't know anything else. I was trained as a physician. I can go and do that. And so I'm going to do that. And I don't really care what the political situation is. I don't know how to even start to comment on things like India-Pakistan relations or Pakistan-America relations or whatever.
Oh, India's offered help.
Right. No, but I mean, you're 100% right. All of the countries are, but I'm talking about when I get asked these questions, they're the way that they're posed is, well, why are you going when Pakistan is whatever? Or why are you going when America's whatever? And for me, it's like, I don't have an answer to that. All I know is that when I go there, I feel at home.
Yes.
When I go there, I mean, even in the podcast that I did back in 2010, somebody said to me, you're here, Christopher Lydon, actually, the person who hosted the podcast, says to me, you're here and you're saving lives. And I said to him, I was like, no, they're saving me.
Yes.
So Sindh has been an absolutely wonderful experience for me. I have received a lot of love and a lot of respect. It's never been like security issues and whatever. For me, I don't even understand that. So my hands are tied as far as what I can do. And being on the ground in 2010, I know what gets done. So I want to go and do it myself and know that whatever money that you guys are donating is going where it's supposed to go.
And the need is so dire that we've put our goal as 50,000, but to me it seems like
a drop in the bucket.
Yes.
Yeah. And that's what I used to say when I was there, when I was in Pakistan. I remember the very first time I went there, I felt like I was going to do something big. Like, I'm going there and I'm going to actually save people and whatever. And I remember 6 months into it, I started to get so depressed because it started to feel like no matter what I do, there's still more to get done. And it's like, where does it stop? And then I had to remind myself, I had to say, listen, this doesn't matter. Don't get caught in all this garbage thinking of like you're doing this or you're doing that or like some end goal. That's not the point. The point of life is to live it every day.
Absolutely. You
yeah, but you did save a lot of people. Like the first day I remember, Geet was in the field in a camp city in Shikarpur. The first day she saw 172 patients.
Wow. By yourself?
By myself.
By herself, yeah.
Unbelievable.
Without breaks, like, there are no restrooms. There was nothing. She did not eat anything. And remember, like, she continued seeing patients after sundown. There is no electricity there. The people, they turned on their cell phone lights. Somebody brought torch and the bugs and insects everywhere. Oh my God. But she did not stop. Even now, like the hospitals, BHUs, RHCs, they're all underwater. There is no medical relief camp in any district, in any province, be it Balochistan, Sindh, KPK, anywhere.
Right.
So imagine, like, you both are going at a much, much, much needed time.
What about you, Sabyn? Why are you going?
Left up to me, I would leave right now and go. Like, this is all I know. Okay. Right now, the situation is that everybody who can go should go. Like, it's not just about Balochistan or Sindh. The entire country needs us. I get very
you feel guilty that you're not able to go sooner than you were planning.
Absolutely. Like, in 2010, left up to me, I would go like right now and do what I did beautifully in 2010. We were amongst the first ones to respond. So yeah, even like today in the morning, I was walking back and forth thinking that should I leave today? Should I go? Because the need is so much. Like, yes, we are going there, but to me, now is the time to go.
Yeah. But I also think that, you know, we don't want to be a liability. So in that way, I feel like you and you have a most extensive experience in disaster relief management. Geet has too. And I don't have it like this. My work area is different, but I just feel like if the water recedes a little bit, then we will be able to do more. And that's why, and also there are practicalities of life that each one of us has to deal with, but that's what, you know, we each have talked about why we're going, what's the magnitude of the problem. And I think our appeal is to everyone to, yes, no, you know, like you said, anyone who can go should go. And there are people who are going. There are people who are I know most, a lot of doctors who are just planning like I am, that I'm going. And we want people, those who can't go, really think about it, that every day, most of us, like I like to have a cup of coffee from Panera or Starbucks or my favorite coffee shop. It costs $5 or $6 with a tip. So just give $6 a day. Think about how much $6 a day is.
Yeah.
And just give that.
What a dollar means for them, especially right now.
So
or one dinner out. You know, think about it, one dinner out with your friends. Just don't go to dinner one week.
Yeah, put a garage sale. Take things out of your house that you don't need. Put a garage sale up. Send us that money. You know, just do whatever you can to help those who are going there.
Yeah.
And also, like, I know there is a disconnect. A lot of people don't know what Pakistan is or like what's going on in Pakistan. But when they do eventually come to know about these floods, they should look at it. Nobody should look at it that, oh, it's Pakistan or it's Haiti or it's India. Or
Kentucky or Tennessee or
like they should look at it at a human is in distress, you know. Like they should look at their thirst, their hunger. There are districts that have not received, like people in so many districts that have not received or seen as a piece of bread.
I want people to look up that video. It's on LifeBridge site also, where this little girl, that's what got to me. This little girl is sitting there with a food bowl in her hand, but there is no food in there and there's flies coming in and out and she's just numb.
Yeah.
And she's just still,
she's pretending.
Almost like she's in a daze.
Yeah.
Like,
please, just like she, that video.
She's imagining that there's food and like she's.
And that just, I couldn't sleep.
Yeah, but when you look close enough, like if a medically trained eye looks close enough at that video, it starts to look like she's going into some sort of hypoglycemic state. Where you get slower and you just start kind of nodding back and forth. And it's very distressing for people who can see.
And we want to think about that due to global warming, there is devastations everywhere.
Climate change.
Even the developed world is getting that now. So and everywhere, like Sabyn said, it's not geographic boundaries. It's not. It's not ethnicity. It's a person, a human being. I cannot live with myself without trying to do something, anything.
We have to do something. It's just sitting here, turning a blind eye, talking about donor fatigue, and here's something else that I really wanted to say too. Remember, a magnitude of this disaster, any disasters, there's always, things are done in layers, in phases, and there's a reason for that. Because it is a very, very taxing experience for relief workers to be there. They are working almost 20-hour days when they're on the ground. They they're going nonstop. I was one of those people where I was seeing patients, 172, 175. There was a day that I think I saw, no jokes, probably somewhere like 220 at my peak. Oh. And it's because the magnitude of disaster is so bad. Each mother's child is on death's door. How are you turning them away? How are you saying, no, I'm sorry, I'm tired, I have to go sleep? Like, that is a horrible, horrible state to be in. And when you're in that place, the level of fatigue, exhaustion, it's not fatigue, it's pure exhaustion. When you're so exhausted, you're so tired, there is a reason, there's a system that the UN, for example, has in place where they only make you work for like 4 weeks at a stretch. And then they send you off to your R&R or whatever. And there's a reason for that. These are very valid things that they have in place through trial and error, because it's such an exhausting experience to do this work. Mentally, physically, we're not even getting to emotionally yet, because most of them don't even know how much PTSD they have from the things that they see. So we're not going there. But point is that it's important to remember that even if we're not there right now, doesn't mean that the work that we're going to go there and do in 2.5 weeks is not going to help. It will be imperative for us to be there.
The and then more people have to go, you know, go in
and
October,
more people have to go,
November,
because you have to do it in
December.
Like,
this is not going
yes,
to go away.
In waves, yeah.
In waves. It's going to come in waves. So if we're going, we're leaving somebody, or we're just adding more to the expanse of work that's getting done. I don't even know how many of the local NGOs that are now on the ground, most of them don't take rest. They just keep going.
Yeah, of course. Like,
you know, it's like when we were hit with a COVID in New York, doctors and nurses came from many other states, Texas, Florida, Georgia, and they helped. And then when they were hit with COVID many months later, then a lot of healthcare workers community from New York went to these days. So it's the same thing. It can be Pakistan, wherever the need is. Right now, 1/3 of Pakistan is underwater.
Yeah.
I don't know what else to say.
I don't know what else to say. Yeah. So now my final thing is going to be, because I think that we've put the point across pretty nicely. My final thought is going to be, I'm going to speak in my mother tongue.
Yes.
To my other Sindhi brothers and sisters, irrespective of religion, irrespective of where it is that you're living. Minji guzarish hai, minji taan ka minti hai. Kuch bhi ta kyo, $10, $5, $20, $100, $1,000, $50,000, jitri taan ji taakat hai, ta kyo, Sindh roye thi vethi. Asana Sindh vaasi dukha mein hain. Edi तबाही है एडी तबाही है जेको असान जे दिमाग जी सोच जिते बंद थी थे ना उन का भी वधी को हुंदी तो जेतरो ता करे ता सको प्लीज ता क्यों असा पाण वेंदा सी असा पाण उन कम के दिसंदा सी असा पाण होते डॉक्टर थींदा सी असा पाण होते टेंस डिस्ट्रीब्यूट कंदा सी एंड जड़ी असा होते हुंदा सी तो असा पेंजु लाइव वीडियोस भी शेयर कंदा सी तो भाई ता भी दिसी सको असा चाहता क्यों थैंक यू वेरी मच आमना
I will apologize to fluent Saraiki speakers because my father is Punjabi and I was brought up in Lahore and my mom is Saraiki, but my Saraiki is very broken, but I will speak it. The me tuakwe dasendi panya ke jithan vi tusan rahnde ho ਸਰਾਇਕੀ ਵਸੇਬ ਸਾਡਾ ਵਸੇਬ ਬੁੜਿਆ ਪਿਆ ਸਾਡੇ ਨਿਆਣਿਆਂ ਕੋਲ ਪੀਣ ਲਈ ਪਾਣੀ ਕਾ ਹੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਰੋਟੀ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਵਿਚਾ ਸੀ ਨਾ ਪਾਣੀ ਕਾ ਹੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਮਾਵਾਂ ਨਿਆਣਿਆਂ ਕੋਲੋਂ ਵਿਸਤਰੀਆਂ ਪਈਆਂ ਨੇ ਜਿਹੜੇ ਇੱਥਾਂ ਬਹੁ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਬਰਬਾਦੀ ਹੈ ਅਸਾਂ ਲੁੱਟ ਪੁੱਟ ਗਏ ਹਾਂ ਅਸਾਂ ਉੱਜੜ ਗਏ ਹਾਂ ਸਾਡਾ ਵਸੇਬ ਸਾਡੀ ਧਰਤੀ ਅਸਾਂ ਦੀ ਮਾਂ ਧਰਤੀ ਉੱਥਾਂ ਰਹਿਣ ਵਾਲੇ ਨਿਆਣੇ ਬੱਚੇ ਮਾਵਾਂ ਪਿਓ ਸਭ ਕੁ ਬੁਲਾਉਂਦੇ ਪਏ ਨੇ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਕੋਲ ਤਾਂ ਇਹ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਪਤਾ ਕਿ ਉਹ ਕਿਹਨੂੰ ਬੁਲਾਉਣ ਸਾਡੇ ਕੋਲ ਅਸਾਂ ਕੋਲ ਕੱਲ ਦੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਵਿੱਚ ਅਸਾਂ ਸੋਚ ਸਕਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਉਹ ਤੇ ਕੱਲ ਦੇ ਆਉਣ ਵਾਲੇ ਝਾੜੇ ਬਾਰੇ ਸੋਚਣ ਵੀ ਕਿਆ ਸੋਚਣ ਤੇ ਮੈਂ ਵੀ ਗੀਤ ਦੇ ਮਾਂਗ ਵਾਲਾ ਤੁਹਾਕੂ ਬੇਨਤੀ ਕਰਨ ਦੀ ਪਈ ਆ ਜੋ ਦੇ ਸਕਦੇ ਹੋ ਤੁਸਾਂ ਦਿਲ ਖੋਲ ਕੇ ਦੇਵੋ ਸੋਚੋ ਇਹ ਬਾਰੇ ਚ ਸਾਡਾ ਵਸੇ ਬੁੱਢਿਆ ਪਿਆ ਹੈ ਤੇ ਉਜੜਿਆ ਪਿਆ ਹੈ ਥੈਂਕ ਯੂ
ਸਬੀਨ
ਮੈਂ ਰਿਕੁਐਸਟ ਕਰੂੰਗੀ ਕਿ ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਮਦਦ ਕਰੇ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਸੇ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਮਦਦ ਕਰੇ ਹਰ ਕੋਈ ਉਠੇ ਪੂਰਾ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਪਲੀਜ਼ ਅਭੀ ਆਪਣੇ ਮਜ਼ਹਬ ਔਰ ਸਿਆਸਤ ਔਰ ਇਨ ਸਾਰੀ ਚੀਜ਼ੋਂ ਕੋ ਬੀਚ ਮੇਂ ਨਾ ਲਾਏ ਮਦਦ ਕਰੇ ਆਪਕੀ ਨਜ਼ਰ ਵੋ ਕਿਸ ਪੋਲੀਟੀਕਲ ਪਾਰਟੀ ਸੇ ਬਿਲੋਂਗ ਕਰਤਾ ਹੈ ਯਾ ਸਪੋਰਟ ਕਰਤਾ ਹੈ ਇਸ ਤਰ੍ਹਾਂ ਕੀ ਸਾਰੀ ਚੀਜ਼ੇ ਸਾਈਡ ਪੇ ਰੱਖੇ ਇਸਕੇ ਲਈ ਪੂਰੀ ਜ਼ਿੰਦਗੀ ਪੜੀ ਹੈ ਪਾਕਿਸਤਾਨ ਮੇਂ ਲੋਗੋਂ ਕੇ ਪਾਸ ਜ਼ਿਆਦਾ ਟਾਈਮ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ ਇਸ ਵਕਤ ਅਗਰ ਮਦਦ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੀ ਖਾਣੇ ਕੀ ਮਦ ਮੇਂ ਪਾਣੀ ਸ਼ੈਲਟਰ ਮੈਡੀਸਨ ਅਭੀ ਵੋ ਲੋਗ ਯੇ ਚੀਜ਼ ਮੰਗ ਰਹੇ ਇਸ ਵਕਤ ਅਗਰ ਮਦਦ ਨਹੀਂ ਕੀ ਤੋ ਫਿਰ ਵੋ ਕਫਨ ਮੰਗੇਗੇ ਨੀਚੇ ਪਾਣੀ ਮੇਂ ਬੈਠੇ ਹੋਏ ਉੱਪਰ ਸੇ ਪਾਣੀ ਬਰਸ ਰਹਾ ਹੈ ਕੁਛ ਵੀ ਨਹੀਂ ਹੈ ਉਨ ਲੋਗੋਂ ਕੇ ਪਾਸ ਪਲੀਜ਼ 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 ਮਦਦ ਕਰੇ ਬਸ
That's it. Thank you very much. I hope you got the information and the questions that you had answered from our podcast. I'm sorry we got a little emotional, but we are actually all very emotionally moved by this, which will probably be the other reason why we're going to go do this. But all of our donation info is now on our Facebook page. Whichever way that you would like to donate, whether it's Zelle, whether it's a direct wire transfer, whether it is using that link, just whatever it is and how much ever it is, it doesn't matter. Just please donate. Thank you.
Thank you.